Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, with our party headed by our minister, Nita Headley, conference chair, delegates and sponsors, the media, it's really good to have you here joining us. And at this time, we'll be having the first session being sponsored by the University of Technology, Jamaica, and that's why I'm here. Our distinguished speaker this morning is being honored with the Distinguished Award, the first award being presented at the conference, and that is the Sir Alister McIntyre Distinguished Award. And for those of us who have been journeying here every year are fully aware of who Sir Alister really is, the contribution he has made to this country and to this initiative. And so at this time, I would like to invite on stage our special awardee, Professor Karsten Dreinhöfer. It is my pleasure to introduce Professor Karsten Dreinhöfer, orthopedic surgeon and health economist, among many other designations, and this year's recipient of the Sir Alister McIntyre Distinguished Award. It is recognition for which his over 30 years of distinguished service to the field of orthopedics and traumatology makes him eminently qualified. Professor Dreinhöfer's love affair with medicine began in 1981 when he entered medical school in Hanover, Germany. He completed his studies at Tufts University and Harvard Medical Schools in Boston, USA, and having taken the decision to specialize in bones, went on to pursue further professional training in orthopedics and trauma management in Germany and Sweden. Since then, his work has been characterized by a most fortuitous link between research and applied clinical medicine. His research in the prevention and rehabilitation of musculoskeletal ailments, back pain, osteoporosis, and osteoarthritis, and sports medicine has led to him being internationally recognized as an expert in the treatment of these conditions. His appetite for teaching and research has found expression in three books, 58 original scientific publications, and over 400 presentations in national and international fora. His position as the current medical director and head of the Department of Orthopedics and Traumatology of the prestigious medical park Humboldtmühle, Berlin, as well as chair of the Institute of Musculoskeletal Prevention, Rehabilitation and Health Services Research, and the Institute of Science and Sports Medicine, both of Humboldt University, has not curtailed his contribution to leadership in his field of specialization. In addition to his service on various boards, academic, national, and international, he has most recently served as Congress President of both the 12th Annual German Congress of Health Services Research and the 12th European Congress of the Federation of National Association of Orthopedics and Traumatology. Described as always on the go and hands-on, rather hands-on go-getter, Professor Dreinhöfer is obviously gifted with abundant energy and an overwhelming passion for his work. We're pleased, very pleased, that his passion has propelled him across the miles from Germany to share with us something of his vast knowledge of the musculoskeletal condition as it relates to sports. Professor Dreinhöfer, we recognize and pay tribute to your many substantial and sustained accomplishments in research, education, and service. And having said that, and in the absence of Sir Alister, I invite our conference chair and president of the University of Technology Jamaica, Professor the Honorable Errol Morrison, to make a presentation to you in this regard.
The University Diabetes Outreach Program, Kingston, Jamaica. The Sir Alister McIntyre Distinguished Award presented to Prof. Karsten Dreinhöfer for excellence in the study of sports medicine and rehabilitation of injuries at its 20th Annual International Diabetes Conference, March 27, 2014. Congratulations, Prof.
Well, Minister, Congress Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, I'm honored. I'm really moved to listen to the young ladies, to attend this conference, and to be able to hopefully discuss with you a little bit what the issue is, the issue of diabetes, the issue of movement, of mobility, of activity. And, well, it was interesting for myself to prepare for this presentation because as much as I like Jamaican music and Jamaican food, I have never been here. And honestly, I didn't know very much about your society beforehand, except some of the people that I've met all over the world. Actually, one of the first guys that I've ever met, well, actually I met him, but he didn't meet me, was Bob Marley. I was in 81 in his last final concert in Germany, and that was one really of my very best concert I've ever attended. And since then, I'm really attached to Jamaica, at least to Jamaican music, and I think after the days here, most probably also to the island. And I will show you a little bit at the end of my presentation about some other connections between Germany and Jamaica. But today my focus will be on injuries, diseases, and sports. As indicated, I'm coming a quite long way, coming from Germany, from a place called Charité, which is the largest university hospital in Europe, with some 3,500 beds. And I'm heading there a department in the Center of Sports Science and Sports Medicine, which is a quite unique center because we try to combine there the social science addressing sports as well as the medical science. And so we bring together basic scientists together with sociologists, with training specialists, with physiotherapists, and try to improve our knowledge about sport and hopefully also the performance of our sports people. But not only doing that, but by learning from the athletes, trying to get hints for treating the normal person, the older person that needs to get up on her or his legs after having fractured her cervical neck with an osteoporotic fracture, or the young person who has somehow suffered a meniscus injury, and many other areas that we will address during this talk. This is my second place where I work. This is a so-called Humboldtmühle, an old mill in the north of Berlin, directly at a lake in front of a nice forest. And in this former mill, we have opened a rehabilitation center, especially for orthopedic patients, for patients after total hip or knee joint replacement, but also for sports injured patients as well as for trauma patients. We also have a lot of cardiovascular patients, most of the time after surgery, and neurological patients with strokes or other neurological diseases. And we try to create some kind of a network, of a research and clinical network between the operating charity unit, between the science center at the Center for Sports Science and Sports Medicine, and the rehab center and try to learn from these interactivities as one can always learn from interacting between different fields. This is our cooperation on the sports level, and as you see here, it's as much on the Olympic level as well as on the individual sports level and on the city level. I would like to present today a couple of issues in regard to sport-related injuries, sport-induced diseases, inactivity-related medical problems, sport as a function of prevention in primary, secondary, and tertiary ways. And if you talk about physical activities, we do not always have to talk about Usain Bolt as much as we like to do that. We sometimes have to talk about continuous physical activities, even in the older ones. Not everybody has to do these kind of activities to stay active. However, it might improve the coordinative capabilities and therefore also the way of getting older. But beside physical activity, there is something called physical inactivity. And I think we all know these kind of problems. There are stairs one can walk, and there are other stairs where one can just stand. And the typical picture is most of the people are standing while walking. This is what we call physical inactivity. And this is an issue not only in Germany, not only in Jamaica, this is a global issue. There's something the World Health Organization has called the global burden of disease. And they have tried with a lot of public health people to analyze what kind of diseases, but also what kind of risk factors do affect the people around the globe. And for example, here are the 20 leading risk factors for the burden of disease. And you see some of the very well-known ones: high blood pressure, tobacco smoking, alcohol, low diets, things like this. But already in the top 10, there's also physical inactivity and low physical activity. Well, what does it mean and why is this important? There's been a recent article in 2013 about behavioral and dietary risk factors for non-communicable diseases, very nicely reviewing what we know about this issue. And we know that, for example, death is attributable to many individual risk factors. Some of the ones we cannot really affect, for example, getting older. Age by itself is a risk factor to die. But to die prematurely is a risk factor usually caused by other issues that we can affect. And one of the main issues we can affect is physical inactivity. And as well as it is a risk factor for premature death, it is a main risk factor for the burden of disease. That means for people who are still alive, but who cannot perform as they would like to perform. They are either pain-ridden or they are hampered by whatever kind of disability. And this kind of burden could be quite a lot lowered by being a little bit more active. The WHO has created a lot of tables, a lot of graphs, and I think some of them are quite helpful to see that the problem is not in every country, in every region the same, that we have to focus in certain areas more on one issue and other areas more on other issues without really forgetting the other risk factors. And if you just look for the little red arrow on the left-hand side pointing onto physical inactivity, you realize that in certain regions in the world, it is really nearly on the top level. In others, it's only, quote-unquote, in the top 10. It is a key issue in all the countries around the world, but in certain areas, even of more importance. And we all have heard how much, for example, also your country has started to realize that smoking is a health hazard, and we have to attack the health hazard of smoke. And people have, on a political level, on a health policy level, tried to inform about the problem and try to limit this issue. The issue of physical inactivity is nearly the same problem, but unfortunately not very much addressed in many areas. You see here the comparison between smoking and inactivity, and you realize that the prevalence is higher for inactivities. The absolute hazard ratio to suffer from the risk problem within resulting disease is a little bit higher for smoking. But if you look for the overall global deaths per year, it is more or less the same effect that smoking has compared to inactivity. So stop smoking and stop being inactive. This is not a quite new message. Already some thousands of years ago, a guy called Plato, living also on a part island a little bit west from here, has said that lack of activity destroys the good condition of every human being, while movement and methodical physical exercises save it and preserve it. At that time, the basic interest in a society was to have people who are well educated on their knowledge level, but also on the physical level. And physical activity was a very high goal in the society. Also, a couple of hundred years later, King Solomon wrote, "There's a time for everything and a season for every activity under heaven." With other words, there's no excuse not to be active. However, times have changed, especially in the last 100 years. And during the early 20th century, for example, complete bed rest was prescribed for patients with acute myocardial infarction. With other words, you have suffered a myocardial infarction, you have to stay in bed, you have to completely recover before you're allowed to get up again. Nowadays, we know that this is the worst thing you can do. And at the time of the 100th boat race between the universities of Oxford and Cambridge in 1954, there was an interesting article published in the British Medical Journal from the senior health officer of Cambridge University, who undertook a study to investigate the dangers of exercise by comparing university sportsmen with other people who are not doing sports but reading books. And fortunately, unfortunately, he couldn't find any major difference between the two groups, but however, if you look for the summary, there was no evidence that the sportsmen died at an earlier age than the group chosen at random. The intellectuals lived longer by a period averaging about 1.5 years, but this small difference might well be due to chance. There was some evidence that the prospects of longevity for the heavily built man was not so good as it was for those more lightly built. No evidence could be adduced from the information available that cardiovascular causes of death were more prominent in the sportsmen or acute in an earlier age. That was just 60 years ago. So obviously we have learned a little bit in these years, or actually we have recovered a couple of things that mankind already knew 2,000 years ago. But despite knowing that on a scientific level and on a brain level, how active is each individual and how inactive is the world's population? There have been some major studies done and large publication series in The Lancet parallel to the last Olympic Games to really report on inactivity as a global health problem, and I show you some of these data. Physical inactivity is defined as not meeting any of these three criteria, and maybe each of you in this room can check if you fulfill one of these criteria. 30 minutes of moderate intensity physical activity on at least 5 days every week. 20 minutes of vigorous intensity physical activity on at least 3 days every week. Or an equivalent combination achieving so-called 600 metabolic equivalent minutes per week. And this is a different issue, what is a metabolic equivalent minutes, but I think we will go on that during the meeting because I'm impressed with quite a lot of the scientific programs that will follow my presentation, so I will not go into depth with every issue. If you talk about physical inactivities in adults, it is interesting to look for the world. Primarily, it's interesting to look into the mirror and ask yourself, how active am I? But also to compare a little bit how active are different areas in the world. And you realize as more blue an area is, as more people are active, or with other words, as reddish a country is and a region is, as more inactive are the people. Unfortunately, Jamaica is so small that you can't really identify it on this map. But I will come back to Jamaica a little later. First of all, it's interesting to watch a little bit the comparison between the different regions in the world. And you, first of all, I think can realize in this graph that it is a global problem, maybe a little bit more expressed in the Americans, in the Eastern Mediterranean, and in Europe, less in Southeast Asia. It is a problem that is increasing with age, so as older people get, as more inactive they are. And looking around in this room, most of the participants here are below 60, so we can be hopeful that most of them are in before the blue column. We then can look for the physical inactivity by sexes, and you see there is no major difference between men and women. It might be a slight higher number of inactivity on the women's side, but not so much. However, what you see, as more money you make, as less you walk, and as less you get active, at least physically active. So I'm not sure if it's always beneficial to earn more money, because obviously this leads to less activity, and as we will see later, to earlier dying. If we then look for the proportion of adults worldwide reporting one of these issues, for example, walking for at least 10 minutes consecutively on 5 or more days per week, you see that it's about 2/3 in most of the age groups. However, vigorous intensity physical activities are about 1/3 of the young people, but much less in the older age groups. On the other hand, people like you and me sitting in a conference for 4 or more hours per day, and I think if you look for the program of today and tomorrow, you might even sit for 8 hours. That is quite high. About 50% of the people really sit day by day more than 4 hours. And knowing that, you should really consider asking yourself, how can I change it, and what can I do in the other 20 hours during the day? This is not only a problem of adults. This is obviously also a problem of children, of young people, of boys and girls, a little bit older than our singers, or maybe the same age as our singers, that are not even achieving 60 minutes per day of moderate to vigorous physical activity. And this is surprising if you see these huge numbers of, in many areas, for example, in North America, 90% of the kids are not achieving 60 minutes per day of appropriate physical activities. This is surprising when you most probably remember your own childhood, or I remember mine. We were out every day for playing soccer 3, 4, 5 hours, and most probably you're doing the same or something else. But it's not the same all over the world. The youth activities, even earlier than my young age, were quite heavily. This is an old picture from some 500 years ago, and shows children's games on a marketplace where it was normal for children not to have an iPad or some kind of a PlayStation, but they were playing by being active. Nowadays, these are the kind of activities you and I see and experience all over. These are different activities that might lead to other results. When looking into this kind of issue, I tried to find some data for Jamaica, and there has been obviously a very interesting health and lifestyle survey a couple of years ago in your country. And looking into this country, you find quite some interesting data. For example, here the level of inactive, low and moderate and high active people in different sexes and ages. And already looking for the graphs, it shows you some differences, and looking for the numbers, it shows you even more that you have a big difference between male and females, obviously. So there is a huge group, nearly 50%, 43% of the females over all age groups who are physically inactive, but only 16% of the males. So why this is the case, maybe you can explain to me, or we can discuss it later. On the other hand, on high physical active levels, there are obviously many more men than women, explaining a little bit the difference. This is a study that Jamaica has done by itself. These are data from the World Health Organization about physical inactivities in adults in 2008. And this reflects a little bit the figures that we just saw from Jamaica, that looking for both sexes, we have something shortly or a little bit below 50% of Jamaican people are inactive. Honestly, I was shocked. For me, Jamaica was a country that really expresses good people that are active, that are happy, that are moving around, that are enjoying life. Most probably you still do most of it, especially enjoying life, but obviously without being physically active. So perhaps you can explain later how you do that. I was even more shocked when I compared it with other countries. I was a little bit satisfied when I realized that the other English-speaking island closer to my country is even worse than your island. That confirmed a little bit my impression, but I was shocked to see that Germans are so active compared to your island, because I always thought we are maybe intellectual and scientifically very active, but not body-wise. However, obviously there are differences. And I went to the WHO homepage and really checked it, and you really see here on the world map that first of all, Jamaica, I think the country number 6 or 7 from the bottom on the left-hand side, is with this percentage of 47.8, and Germany is the second one from the top with 28% listed. So there seemed to be some truth in it. But what might be the result for it is actually the kind of way how people participate in going from A to B. And in Germany, as you can see here, many people, for example, walk to work. So they, for example, go with public transportation somewhere, but then they continue to work to their final destination. And this seems to be quite a large number. Cycling is still something pretty big in Germany. Looking for the traffic in Jamaica, I'm not sure how much cycling is really safe here, so maybe it's even a more bigger health hazard, but still the activity by itself is quite worthwhile. Why are physical activities so important? Well, physical inactivity is the leading cause of diseases and disability associated. And you see here some of the most well-known: coronary heart disease, stroke, obesity, diabetes, hypertension, but also cancer, for example. Not only colorectal cancer, also breast cancer is correlated with physical inactivity. But also psychological issues like stress and anxiety are much more expressed in a group of inactive people than in physical active people. And even osteoarthritis and osteoporosis, issues that are very interesting for orthopedic surgeons, are higher in the inactive people. Most of the time you would expect that people who are running and who are doing exercises all day long stress their joints so much that they will lose their cartilage much earlier. The opposite is true. Because of the activities, a lot of nutritional issues come to the joint and allow the joint to refreshen again and obviously to stay longer active. For osteoporosis, it's the same issue. If you train your bones quite early enough with being very active in young years and continue staying active, your bones will be much stronger and the risk for a fragility fracture, for a bone fracture in older ages, is much lower. And also low back pain is an issue that can be severely reduced by physical activity. So there has been in this Lancet issue also an article looking for the effects of physical inactivity on major non-communicable diseases worldwide, and they have analyzed the burden of disease and life expectancy in these consequences. Here they looked for coronary heart disease, type 2 diabetes, breast cancer, colon cancer, and all-cause mortality. And first of all, you see in the top line the prevalence of the inactivity in the population all over, and then the prevalence of inactive people eventually developing the outcome. And based on these two figures, you can calculate the relative risk of this individual person and the relative risk of this risk factor to really have an influence on developing the disease. And you realize that inactivity obviously has quite a strong effect on getting one of these four diseases or for dying earlier. And if you break it down once again a little bit more from the global level to Latin American and Caribbean side and even down to Jamaica, you see that there is some kind of 8% of the overall risk of suffering from coronary heart disease is related to inactivity. About 10% of the type 2 diabetes, even 14% of breast cancer in Jamaica, 14% of colon cancer, and 13% of premature deaths in Jamaica is correlated to inactivities. It's different a little bit over the between the different countries here all over the world. And here I have the figures for the Caribbean islands around. And as I've heard that there are a lot of people from the neighboring islands, you might realize that there are differences between the islands, which I find quite interesting. So for example, if you look for Dominica, it is a little bit higher in all the issues compared to Jamaica. If you look a little bit further, even to South America, to Argentina, it is much higher than here. But if you then look for Guatemala, it is about one third of the risk in Jamaica. What are the differences there? Why the people in Guatemala are so much more active than in Jamaica? Perhaps somebody can explain a little bit later to me. But if we look for an issue like this, an estimated gain in life expectancy, so there's a present out there that you get an additional year of life as a present, just for free, if you stay active. Well, some people might, from an economical point, calculate, does it make sense to invest 60 years of my life to be active, to in the end only gain 1 year? But this is a kind of calculation that everybody has to do for himself or herself. These estimated gains in life expectancies are also reflected a little bit by the numbers that we saw before, difference between the islands here. Jamaica is nearly really at about 1 year. Dominica is only about half a year, and Argentina is about 1.4 years. But if you recall earlier, the Argentinians had this as one of the main risk factors, so obviously if you fight a risk factor, you can benefit from it. And here you realize where the countries are that benefit most, and Jamaica is somewhere in the middle. So what shall we do? And what shall you do? What shall you advise your patients, your family? These are the advices from the CDC from the US, and they are based on the WHO recommendations that have been published a couple of years earlier. For substantial health benefits, adult people need to do at least 2 hours and 30 minutes, altogether 150 minutes each week, of moderate intensity aerobic activities. Or 1 hour and 15 minutes, 75 minutes, each work of vigorous intensity. Or an equivalent mix of moderate and vigorous intensity aerobic activities. However, aerobic activities should be performed for at least 10 minutes at a time. So it's not enough to run up and down the stairs here in the hotel once and said, well, I've been active and I do this 5 times a day. You have to do it 10 minutes at a time to really see an effect. Besides these aerobic activities that have been forced quite a lot over the last, let me say, 20 years, in the recent years, we have also realized that the muscle strengthening activities are a different part of high importance. Muscle strengthening should be done 2 or more days a week, and all major muscle groups should be worked. These are the legs, the hips, the back, the abdomen, the chest, the shoulders, and the arms. And exercises for each muscle group should be repeated 8 to 12 times per set. This is an interesting aspect because we haven't really addressed that for many, many years, but nowadays we know that some people are perfectly trained on an aerobic level but are muscular, unstable and weak, and most of the time also balance-wise very badly positioned. So this issue of a combination between aerobic, muscle strengthening and postural stability as a third point are definitely recommendable for everybody. Well, here we have listed these kind of activities once again, a little bit easier to read. And as already pointed out a little bit earlier, the question is how to do it and when to really achieve these minutes. There is something that has been named over the last years in the Western world, the so-called weekend warrior. These are the people who are sitting in their offices 10, 12, 14 hours a day, 5 days a week, and then on the weekend they try to be active. Or travel around the world, going from one airport to the other, and their only activities is walking from a gate to the plane. But then, when they come home on the weekend, they try to be active. The question is, what kind of activities are really looked for? Well, we look here in this analysis for walking, climbing stairs, and sports and recreation. And we call somebody sedentary if a man is expending less than 500 kilocalories per week. We call him insufficiently active if he is expending something between 500 and 1,000 kilocalories a week. And a weekend warrior is defined as a person who has, by the end of the week, done enough. He has expending more than 1,000 kilocalories a week by participation in sports and recreation only one or two times a week. So these are the people who then do maybe a half marathon on the weekend. And we compare that with regularly active people, with all other men expending more than 1,000 kilocalories a week, but doing it more regular over the week. And if you look then for the relative risk of mortality according to this physical activity pattern, then it's quite interesting. Actually, this is a study based on the Harvard Alumni Health Study. And you see here that a sedentary person, a person who is not doing a lot, has a relative risk of mortality of about 1.0. If you're insufficient active, but a little bit active, you can reduce your risk to the factor of 0.5. And if you're a weekend warrior, you can even improve it, because you're doing more than the insufficiently active. But this is only for people at low risk. If you look for the high risk men, and these are the ones who really need that, it looks completely different. Well, first of all, what does high risk mean? High risk men are men who have at least one of the following risk factors. Either they smoke, they are overweight, meaning a BMI above 25, they have a history of hypertension, or they have hypercholesterolemia. Looking around in this room, I could follow Professor and ask around who of you have any of these risk factors, but I won't ask that because this is too personal. But if you look for it, and if you then consider the relative risk of mortality for this high-risk man group, and I'm not showing the female data, you realize that these guys are usually the ones who are successful. Because they are successful, they can smoke a little bit more, they can eat a little bit more, and they have maybe some other risk factors. And they have realized their risk factors and they try to be active on the weekend. But by being active on the weekend, being one of these weekend warriors, they're at the same risk like the sedentary people. So with other words, they could also stay at home and watch TV, or they could change and should change to a more regular activities, because if these people are regular active, they can also reduce their absolute risk of mortality by 40% by doing some kind of regular 1,000 kilocalories activities over the week. So the question is, why are some people physically active and others not? And there are definitely many different areas we can touch. There's an individual area, there's an interpersonal area, environment, regional and national policies might have an impact, and the global development might have an impact. There's obviously on the individual level a difference in the psychological motivation, cognition, and belief about the importance of moving around. And there are also some biological differences. Some people are sick, some people have some health issues, some people have some genetic factors that might make it a little bit more difficult, but these are the kind of things that you might not actively affect, but what you can affect is during your later life, how you get along with these kind of problems. How you get along, it quite often depends on the interpersonal relationships that you have in the family, in the group of friends, or at work. How much it is accepted that you might, for example, have diabetes, and due to that, need to adapt your life a little bit differently, but you still can and should be bodily active. However, there are certain cultural areas where it is not good to be active, and especially females, for example, should not run and should not participate in sports. That is definitely not in Jamaica, at least for the moment. I think cultural, there is no real hampering of participating. But there are other areas in the Middle East, for example, where one should consider twice as a female to really participate in sports. Then there is a question, where can you do it? Where are sports activity opportunities? What does the policy, what does the government, what does the community provide on sports facilities? What kind of built environments are there? Are there green places around where people can be active? Are there neighborhood walkabilities? Is there public transport? All these kind of issues, but also the natural environment is an important factor. Then it's a question, obviously, of the economy on a regional and national policy. As richer, as we have realized, some societies get, as more they have public transportation, they have all kind of urban planning, where you don't really need to move to come from A to B. This is nice, this is fast, but this is not healthy. So obviously a lot of issues from a non-medical or non-directly medical viewpoint that need to be addressed in combination with politicians, with active people in a region, but also with doctors and medical professionals. If you realize how much physical activities correlate in different countries of low and middle income with some of these issues, you realize that demographical and biological aspects are obviously the dominant ones. In this study, the psychological and cognitive issues were only on minor importance. I personally believe they are of major importance, and it is a very critical issue how much an individual person is motivated and convinced that this kind of activity is important for him and her. So what kind of lessons have we learned around the world about evidence-based intervention in physical activities? Well, there are different ways to motivate people, and you can do everything from a modern computer-tailored app that tells you get up and run around your desk to some kind of physical activity counseling from a doctor telling you it helps you, to healthy adults around you, and you have some kind of peer pressure because you're the only fat and immobile one. So there are different areas definitely to motivate people. And basically you can put it on three levels: on the informational approach, a community-wide and mass media campaigns, short physical activity messages targeting key community sites. I had the pleasure to be shortly interviewed by one of the radio guys sitting outside. Definitely these kind of small community messages in between the music is helpful for everybody to think, oops, have I been walking today already? Or shall I take the stairs or shall I take the elevator? The next approach is a behavioral and social approach. Social support for physical activity within communities and work sites. Is this appropriate to have some kind of time off the work to be active at the work site? A secretary that sits for 8 to 10 hours in an office definitely is not very active beside running to the copy machine. There might be workers stimulated opportunities that there is a break every 3 or 4 hours where people do something together. I was very impressed a couple of months ago when I was in China to see the Tai Chi movement that they have there as a cultural issue, but that is still very active in many of their factories and office buildings where people really come into a breakfast break and do Tai Chi exercises together. School-based strategies that encompass physical education or classroom activities to force the class to get up, to move around for a couple of minutes and go back to the learning. After school sports, how much is this stimulated and how much do people have to walk or drive to school and home? And the last issue, environmental and policy approaches. Unfortunately, the minister has already left. Otherwise, I think she would definitely support us in all these kind of important issues in regard to community scale, street scale, urban design and land use. All these kind of activities that are important. The interaction between a sports minister and a minister of development. So there's definitely a global action needed for public health to fight this pandemic of inactivity. And they have developed here a certain area how one can interact with behavioral and environmental and systems approaches, physical inactivity. It is on a theoretical level quite obvious and quite easy to approach. Surprisingly, in most countries, we have not succeeded so far. So the next level will definitely be to implement it according to the local standards and local expectation on a different level. There's, on the other hand, also some risk of the sport. And I just want to share with you some German data on what are, at least in my country, the typical sports injuries and what can happen and how can we deal with it. And this is actually not a sample of a sports club or of a school or something like this. This is really based on a German National Health Survey where we have looked for all other kind of medical issues, but also for sports injuries. And we realized that about 3% each year sustain a sports-related injury, and the annual incidence of an injury among those who are really actively engaged in sports is higher, is nearly double as high, is about 5.6%. So obviously, as well and as good and important activity is on one hand side, it also creates some health problems on the other hand. These are the typical injuries. The majority of these injuries are, however, of minor importance. They are distortions, dislocations, maybe rupture of ligaments. These are about 2/3 of the injuries. There are some minor head injuries that are obviously also of minor importance. However, there are also some fractures, 4% of the upper extremity, 8% of the lower extremities, and other fractures, 5%. So there's altogether some 15% of, or 18% of fractures, and also some open wounds. So some serious sports injuries are definitely there, but the majority is definitely of minor importance. If you compare this distribution of injury severity between sports injury and other opportunities to suffer from an accident, domestic accidents, occupational accidents, or even an accident in road traffic, you realize that all the other ones end up in a much higher number with severe injuries. So it's still quite safe to participate in sports compared to participating in road traffic, working, or even being at home. If you then look for the incidence and risk of sports injuries as a function of sex, age, and time spent exercising, you see as more you're doing sports, as higher your risk is. Well, this is in a way an argument for these people who stay at home and say, I don't try to be active. But this is definitely a mistake. Because we first of all realize that most of the problems occur in the very young age when the people are really active, sometimes also not risk aware, meaning they try to find their limits and sometimes go over their limits, and by doing that they might even get injured. On the other hand, if they look for the estimated injuries over time and over the age groups, you realize the biggest group is in the group under the age of 30, and a little bit only in the older group where the people are understanding that their sports activities are for the health benefit and not for the health risk. So, with other words, as older you get, as safer it is to be actively involved in sports. Try to stay in sports is good for your health. If we then know that these injuries that might occur usually do not end up with any disablement, in most of the cases in a disablement below 30 days, I think one can still recommend to everybody to participate in sports, in physical activity, by being risk aware, but then stay active. If we look for the overall risk to suffer an injury in this group, we realize first of all in a univariate analysis that these are men, younger subjects, and subjects of normal weight. But the highest incidence of injury actually are in the group with a high level of alcohol consumption and unhealthy eating habits. That doesn't mean that people who drink alcohol shouldn't perform sports, but hopefully not at the same time. And it doesn't mean that if people have an unhealthy eating habit that they are really prohibited to participate in sports. They should start doing it, but most probably these people have, at least in the beginning, some more coordinative problems than others, and therefore a little higher risk for injuries. If you, however, try to eliminate this function of opportunity, meaning as more people are active, as more people get injured, in a logistic regression analysis, the only things that stay then as a risk factor are age and gender, meaning being very young, maybe not aware enough of the problems, and being male, meaning also quite often not being aware of the problems, is a combination that one should address and maybe also focus in a prevention program. This is a prevention program starting very early, and this is actually coming now to the end of my talk, a few pictures from Berlin, from our center, where we try to work in a very interesting setting. For example, here in different rooms with a lot of sports students and elite sports people, in a room where we can analyze the gait and the overall mobility. You see these small little lamps on the body that allows to analyze the overall body activity with a high resolution camera, and then analyze how this person is running and coming from A to B. But not only the sports people, also injured people, also some of my operated patients can be analyzed and further on trained in an appropriate gait matter based on these analyses. Here also combining it with radiographic analysis, so you can look for the functional issue as well as for the real bone-on-bone contact and analyze what's going wrong. Not only in regard to walking and running, but also, for example, here for people doing some things on their hand. We have obviously all kind of weight machines, but we do not only do the weight lifting, we do a lot of analyses with these kind of instruments. And we can, by the close collaboration between a preclinical basic science research group with 110 people on third-party grants, doing analysis of cartilage, of bone, of fibrous tissue, see and watch what went wrong in the elite sports people, and what can we learn from the regeneration in the sports person for the regeneration in the normal public area about getting older and still staying healthy. So I promised you I come up with some more relations between Berlin and Jamaica. This is actually, these are pictures from the World Championships in 1999 in Berlin, where Usain Bolt already had his gold medal from Beijing, but then he tried to become world champion, and he is here together with a Berlino that was the mascot of the World Championship, and they tried to compete against one another. Not very successful, Berlino ended. You see here Usain when he started and in the final when he won in a very decent way with a new world record and was celebrating Jamaica all over Germany, and it became quite popular there. But it was not only him, there were a lot of other ladies around being very active, being very successful and being loved by Berlino, the mascot. We had a year afterwards the first Jamaican-German sports forum in Berlin. That was actually an initiative of the Jamaican embassy commemorating the 50th anniversary of the independence of your country. And there was Honorary Patrick Robinson, a judge, who has together with us talked about the sports in Jamaica. And most of you most probably know this lady, Merlin Otte, was there. And she spoke to us about her life, her career, and the need of being active. And she was not only welcomed by me, she was also honored as an athlete par excellence by the ambassador, Mrs. Wheeler, who congratulated her to her career. And you see everybody was willing to take a picture with such an successful and athletic person. We had some press reports about this activity, and I think that, and I hope that this was a first step to a nice collaboration between Germany and Jamaica in regard to sports science and in regard to medical exchange. I've learned in these days a lot about Jamaica, and I think we can learn a lot from your country, from your dealing with sports, of supporting young people to get into sports, becoming at least sports. But most probably you can also learn a little bit from us in regard to staying active and stay for longer time active. Oops. And this is actually a thank you from Berlin, a thank you from my side to the universities, to the sponsors of the Congress, to being invited here, to be able to share my little talk with you and hopefully to share the discussion with you. To invite you to Berlin, this is a place where I'm staying, where I'm living, and I would like to welcome you all to come here. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Can we give him another hearty round of applause? Quite enlightening. Before we break, let me take the opportunity of thanking Professor in a more tangible way by presenting the citation that I read earlier this morning.